So I got this title today. Why do I have this title? Well, number one, it just came to me. You preach enough years and things start, everything starts to rhyme, you know. And another reason is it's every woman kind of needs her heart heated up sometimes, maybe all the time. And every man wants to think about his wife as a holy hottie. That's David slang for godly woman, holy hottie. And so I want to start off today with some things not to do when you want to, like, these are not the Christian way to heat up the heart of a holy hottie. This is like these, here's some Christian kind of pickup lines. I want you to see these pictures for just a minute. Here's one. Hey girl, I know that I'm not Boaz, but you can glean my fields anytime. Hey girl, I put the stud in Bible study. That's not it, guys. That's not how it works, okay? Look at the next one. I was going to read Proverbs 31, but then I just realized I could study you instead. That's not a good way to heat up her heart. Let's read another one. So if I marched around you 7 times, would you fall for me? Hashtag walls of Jericho. Hey, girl, want to highlight Bible verses together? I don't know. That might be a little closer. How about this one? The Bible says to think about whatever is pure and lovely. That's Philippians. So I've been thinking about you all day. Hey, girl, I work out my salvation with fear and trembling. Another Bible verse there. How about another one here? Hey, girl, is it hot in here or is that just your holy fire? That's pretty bad, isn't it? Well, let's see what the Bible has to say. Let's see what 1 Peter chapter 3 has to say. 1 Peter, let's have the Apostle Peter, let's see what his heating the heart, his line is. Husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives and treat them with respect. These words that are capitalized today are the main point and function of the message. Be considerate, live with, and treat them with respect. As the weaker partner, and we'll get into what that means in a minute, as the weaker partner and as heirs with you in the gracious gift of life, so that nothing will hinder your prayers. This verse, in the end of it, it indicates that if I don't treat my covenant spouse, if I don't treat Melanie, if you don't treat your wife, if there's not anyone in your life, especially your partner, that's not treated like this, then your prayers, your relationship with God gets hindered by you how you treat another person. And so let's look today at 3 things that will warm the heart of a godly woman toward her man. Now, if you're sitting next to your spouse or boyfriend or girlfriend or fiance today, men, I would go ahead and advise you in advance to watch out for the ribs today, okay? Just watch out right here, okay? So that's what good reason to be the pastor preaching today. Melanie can't quite get to me quite as far. I have to get down there, let her elbow me a little bit today. But just watch out for the ribs. I should have passed out like rib protectors, some kind of a stick. Yeah, I guess Melanie needs this. Poking with a stick. There you go. But number one, hey, that's right. You say it, buddy. Understand my wife. Be considerate means to understand her. Be considerate means to understand her. Okay, there was a man who was walking on the beach in Southern California. It was a beautiful day. It was gorgeous, gorgeous weather. And this wind in his face, and he began to pray. I mean, he just turned his heart towards the Lord, all the gorgeous weather and everything, and he began to pray, and he had this deep communion with the Lord. He could hear the Lord's voice, and he just knew that whatever prayer he'd ask, that God would answer, because he was just that close with God in that moment. And so God did speak to his heart and said, you know, just call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you don't know. That passage from Jeremiah, he was thinking about that. And so he did ask God a question. He said, God, we're right here in Southern California. Could you build me a highway all the way to Hawaii so I could just go there anytime? all the way to Hawaii. You just have to take my car and go all the way to Hawaii. Anybody like a highway to Hawaii? Doesn't that sound good? And so the Lord responded and said, you know, I'm not saying I couldn't do that, but obviously I didn't do that. Hawaii is out there. You're over here. There's an ocean between. I made the ocean. But let's just think about that, the Lord says back to him. You know, just think about that. You got to have pylons go all the way down to the bottom of the ocean. You got sharks going on there. You got jellyfish. You got blue whales. Think of the environmentalists involved. Just think of all the problems. You know, you got oil tankers that are going to have to somehow get under it or get over it. It's a lot going on here. And so just think about this. I could do it. It's kind of materialistic. But I really think that you ought to ask for something a lot more, just a whole lot more godly of a request. So the man thought again, and he said, you know what? I've always wanted to understand my wife. God, could you just allow me to understand women? You know, the Lord's response was, how many lanes do you want that highway? How many lanes do you want that highway? You know, it's hard because we're all made different, right? We're all made different. And not only that, but every woman is different. Very different. And there was a study done at Harvard. Not the insurance company, the school, the Harvard. Yeah, at Harvard, done by preschoolers. Just kind of studying brain waves and chemical reactions and neurophysiology. And they studied these preschoolers. And of the little girl preschoolers, 100% of the sounds that they made, 100% of the sounds they made were language related. They were communicative in some way. They were language related. And then for the little boys, 60% of the sounds they made were language related. You know what 40% of the sounds were? And a lot of us guys, we haven't made it a lot farther than that. Since then. But it starts out and it says, be considerate. Be considerate. Communication can be very difficult. In counseling, as a pastor, sometimes people will come in and they'll have a money problem or a problem with sex life or some kind of a problem with in-laws or all kind of different problems. But most problems are not the problem. Most problems are communication problems. And most problems about communication aren't problems of talking. They're problems of listening. But we're hardwired, really, to be different. Another study showed that an average woman has about 25,000 words she has to say every single day. You know, like the foot counter, you know, the what's it called, the Fitbit, you know? There's a word counter, like ding, 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 a lot of, not, of course, not everybody. But a lot of ladies now. In my family, I'm the lady that's got 25,000 words to get out per day. In my family, because so you can be different like that way. And a man is usually probably, you know, it's less than 10,000 words. That's on a good day. Right, Bland? That's a good day. I mean, what do you think? That's a good day, Steve. Like 10,000 words. What do you think? It's a good day. Yeah. And so that means... You know, that means 45 minutes to an hour worth of words she's got to get out every day. And for the man, that's like 15 minutes. For him, 10,000 words in 15 minutes total over the day, he can get his 10,000 words out total. And so what does that leave her with? That leaves an hour and a half of silence that she's got to figure out what to deal with, unless the tables are turned in your family. You know, so not just in those communication, not just to... fix her. See, the 10,000 words are plenty of words to fix her. See? 10,000 words are plenty of words to fix her. But 25,000 words it takes to ask questions and understand and even listen. It'd be different, men, if those the difference between the 10,000 and the 25,000 we actually spent listening. But sometimes, like, we can't listen to more than that. I mean, you ever get like, man, you ever get like the word overload? Like, I can't, there's not any more words that can go in. Melanie tells me all the time she gets the word overload. But you get the word overload. One of you in your family is going to get the word overload. It's not just about how many words you can speak. It's about how many words you can hear in a day. It doesn't matter. If the next words were like, we won the lottery, you'd be like, click, click on the channel. You know, the next words were like, hey, let's go to Bermuda. I've got a free tickets. You know, click. I've got to zone out at that point. Well, so the definition is to be thoughtful of the needs and feelings of another, to be in tune with their feelings, in tune. You know, in music, when you have, you know, two wavelengths going on, and if they match perfectly, they just go, the wavelengths just go like this. But if they mismatch, they start going like this, and it's, you get that warbly, out of tune sound. A lot of couples are out of tune. They're trying to sing in unison or try to sing in harmony, but it's out of tune, bad, out of tune. And so we got to be able to discern, men, we got to discern feelings and respond to them accordingly. Now, you think this is easy for me to talk about. This is not easy to say. So let's just try to help me out here. We got to be able to discern feelings. Oh, me, right? And respond accordingly. But sometimes when we hear about feelings that we don't like, what do? Ladies, you shut down. Ladies, you ever had your feelings ignored? I'm not starting a fight here, am I, today? You ever had your feelings belittled, like you shouldn't have that feeling? Well, you shouldn't have that feeling because of this logical thing. It doesn't, like, you do the math on the problem, and at the end of the math problem, there's no feeling at the end. That feeling should not exist, but it does. Feelings aren't math. Oh, here's another one. Understand moods. Understand moods. I'm getting an amen on this side over here from Angela. She's giving me one of those. Understand moods. Have you ever had a mood? Yeah. Have you ever had a mood over here? Anybody, ladies over here, ever had a mood? Ever had a mood? Every day, ever had a mood? Is that Jasmine said every day? Oh, man. Some days she'll be blue and need an extra dose of tenderness. Some days she'll be fed up with kids or the house or money or even her job and need you to give her some extra relief. Some days she'll feel lonely and she'll need extra time from you. Some days she'll feel unlovely and she'll just keep the credit card payment balance down so that on the day you have no money and she feels so unlovely, then she gets a nice dress. Then she gets something new for her hair. Something that she can do to feel attractive on the day she doesn't feel lovely. You ever tried to tell them, but darling, you're gorgeous. But if she doesn't feel gorgeous, there's no amount of words that can make her feel gorgeous. So I reach into my bag of tricks. You know, I preached a lot of marriage sermons, and so I'm looking through my notes. And I'm back there going like, what can I say? And I can't find anything. I'm looking in my notes. I'm trying to find what can I say? What can I do? There's nothing to say. There's nothing I can do. There's no system, men. Don't you just want a system? Don't you want a system? Like, you know, when this happens, do that. If then that. If then that. I got one Bible verse for you, Dave. That's all I got, man. Otherwise, you got to go back to those bad pickup lines. But you want a system, don't you? Want a system. Like the engine, if I get an engine just right in tune, it's a system. If it work, you know, you have management systems. There's no organized system to have a woman feel good. Now, let me talk about this system for just a minute. There's no system. Let me explain the system. There's no system. And all my life, I've searched for a system, but there's not a system. Here's the system. Understand. Be considerate of that which you do not understand. Be considerate, understand, and receive that which you don't agree with. Listen to that which you don't like. Sensitivity grows out of communication. More than just talking, it's looking, listening, and learning. Many wives say that husbands are blind and deaf, understanding their needs and desires. So busy trying to fix it, I can't fix her and understand her. Ladies, you want to say that? You can't fix me and understand me. Let's try it again. You can't fix me and understand me. When you're fixing me, it means you don't want to understand me. See, understanding is the fix. So I need a new tool in my toolbox back here. Like, oh, here's my wrench. I want to knock her out with it. No, here's my wrench. Here's my wrench. This wrench is called, it's the wrench of understanding. I mean, if I don't know over here, here's the caliper. It's the caliper of understanding. Here's the hammer. No, let's leave that alone. So understand, if I understand, I'm 90% there. Even if I don't understand, I should fake it. Or I should say, I don't understand. But I'm with you. So that requires attention, doesn't it? Because, ladies, how long is the attention span of the man that you're with? How long is his attention span? If I can't find it, fix it, re-engineer it, like I love the video from last week. I was trying to just understand, but in the middle of listening, I found a 7-point plan to fix it. See, every part of the human body communicates. You know, I like verbal communication. You like verbal communication? Some of you like verbal communication. Some of you like nonverbal communication. Some of you like written communication. Some of you like just figure it out communication. Communication. The eyes, what can the eyes show in a lady's eyes? What can they show? Yeah. What kind of emotions can they show?
Anger.
Anger. Anger. What other kind of emotions? Yeah. Man, how about this lady? Man, have you ever thought you knew just what she was thinking by her eyes and you were wrong? That's just, those eyes are just, they says they're a window to the soul. That doesn't mean you get into the soul. You can tell there's somebody in there through the window, but you can't always tell what they're doing through the window. The eyes, the body, you can tell by the body, tired, depressed. The mouth is saying one thing, the body's saying, please cook tonight. The tone of the voice often reveals truth behind their words. Here's a little secret I found. Don't think that you really are a big man if you understand what the tone of the voice means. Especially don't say you understand what the tone of the voice means. Just do what the tone of the voice means. Because then at that point you're responding to emotions that she doesn't always verbalize. Ask yourself, here's some notes, guys. Ask yourself, does she need comfort? Okay, I bring out my cheat sheet. I see those eyes. I see the way she's acting. I hear the tone of voice. Does she need comfort? Does she need encouragement? Does she need help? Does she need to be left alone? Does she need comfort? Does she need encouragement? There's no system. The one thing one day that means, please encourage me, the next day means leave me alone. So if you ever think to yourself, okay, I've got this down, I'm going to have this figured out, I'm not in kindergarten anymore, I think I'm in husband first grade, you're in kindergarten. Because the rules change and the systems change. That's why in the scripture, it always talks about, you know, one man and one woman forever, the best you can do. You're not in control of everybody else, but according to you, it meant from the beginning, it's one man and one woman. We have a hard time figuring out anything to do with one woman, right? You keep switching. You lose every time. So spend time is the next one. Understand my wife. Number two, spend time with my wife. That's the live with. When it says live with, it doesn't mean live with. It means live with your wife. Live with. Most modern marriages suffer from a simple lack of togetherness. Just a simple lack of togetherness. See, you can't understand and be considerate with somebody that you don't spend any time with. And don't say it's just one of you, it's both of you. This world is contagious with busyness with no power. Careers have destroyed relationships. Outside interests have destroyed them. Lack of time together opens up a deep soul loneliness. I've seen people, the only thing they got wrong in their relationship is they don't spend time together. And it opens up this deep soul loneliness. The successful relationships I know about are ones where you have to choose, I could take that promotion, but it would mean less time. And they don't take their promotion. I could take a second job, or I could just spend less money and not need the second job. And then you make those decisions because in the long run, loneliness is expensive because loneliness makes somebody vulnerable. And a man or a woman who is lonely and vulnerable always does something that's expensive. The definition to live with means to share my life, do things together, be companions. And so the minimum I think any Christian couple has got to do is a date night once a week, a night or a weekend away, or at least without the children, once a quarter, once a month is better. And once a year, pay, bribe, steal, do anything you've got to do to get the dogs and the children taken care of to spend a week away. It's much more expensive to have a lonely spouse in the long run. It's much more expensive to not spend time with in the long run. So if it doesn't look, if you say, well, I can't do that. Well, what can you do? Well, I can't, maybe you can't do that, but you can do some. You can do the same thing a different way, can't you? And by the way, don't take other people along with you. There's no such thing as a week alone with your friends. Number three, it says be considerate. Number two is live with. Number three is treat them with respect. This is honor her, honor my wife. The value of a wife. Proverbs 31:10 says, an excellent wife who can find? For her worth is far above jewels. Proverbs 24:4 says, an excellent wife is the crown of her husband. Proverbs 18:22 says, he who finds a wife finds a good thing. It obtains favor from the Lord. Who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. This one guy went to a psychiatrist and he said, you know, sir, I just really think you're milquetoast, you're henpecked. You are a man who just gets walked on and stepped on all the time, and I'm really concerned about you. So you need to go home and you need to show your wife who's boss. And so he went home from the psychiatrist. He was thinking, okay, I got excellent advice from somebody with a certificate on the wall. And I'm going to go home, and I think this must be right. I've got to really assert myself as a man. And he went home, and he barged in the house, and he said, where's my supper? And he said, from now on, you're going to have my supper ready when I get home. And then he said, and by the way, you're going to serve it to me. And after supper, I'm going out with the boys, and you're going to stay home where you belong. He was being the man, right? Then he said to her, and when I wake up in the morning, I want my clothes laid out and pressed for me for work. And then he said, and who do you think is going to comb and fix my hair and shave my face? And you know what she said? She said, the undertaker's going to do that. The undertaker's going to comb your hair and shave your face. He didn't really have the honoring thing down. What does it mean? It means to treat them with respect. Preach it, sister. Preach them with respect. Any elbows? Anybody got any elbows yet today? Definition. Show that I put her needs and desires ahead of my own by my words, attitudes, and actions. So that I put her needs ahead of my own by my words, my attitudes, and my actions. Practical ways to assign honor. Tell her you love her and you appreciate her. You don't say this, I told you I loved you when we got married. If anything changes, I'll let you know. That's not what I'm talking about. Tell her you love her and you appreciate her. Tell others, now look, watch this. Tell others that you love her and appreciate her and what you appreciate about her in her presence. Do you know that nobody will, not many people will approach your spouse in an immoral way if they hear you brag on them in groups of people? If somebody hears you and your spouse brag on each other and appreciate each other and love each other openly and publicly, that person who's got the target will say, I better target somebody else. He's loved. She's loved. I better target somebody else. Number three, treat her like the scripture says, is an heir of the gracious gift of life before God. Treat them with respect. And the scripture says in 1 Peter 3, it says, as the weaker vessel. Doesn't that sound good, guys? See, you're weaker. And that's been misinterpreted many times in many ways. The part of the gender that brings forth another human out of her body is now weaker. The one who can be sick, nurse a child, fix dinner for the other child, and still go to work. That's not a weaker vessel, right? What does this mean, a weaker vessel? I had a seminary professor. He explained it so good. I'll always just be so excited and give him credit for this. He said, guys, I finally figured out what the scripture was talking about here and what Peter meant. When he says a weaker vessel, of course he means, you know, like you could arm wrestle her and probably win. You know, there's some muscular strength differences for some. But what is it really? What's the depth of the meaning? If you went today online to Amazon and you ordered a $5,000 vase, not a vase, a vase, and it was crystal, it was a crystal vase, and it came in the mail, and it was in a package, what would it say on the outside of that package? Fragile. And what else would it say? Handle with care. This is what this means. Treat them with respect as a $5,000 crystal vase that you got in the mail that says handle with care, fragile. And as you open that, you would treat that with such honor, respect, and glory that you would never want to break it. Because a wife's heart, just like a crystal vase, once it's broken, doesn't really get put back together again. So here's three ways. Pamper her, protect her, and praise her. You may take notes today. Pamper her, protect her, and praise her. Pamper her, by doing so, you let her know that you want her to feel like a woman. Protect her physically, that she feels secure in your presence. Emotionally, that her burdens are lifted. You're not adding to them. See, men get to this place where they can't handle any more burdens. They just start to block everything out. Men, like, just throw it off. Throw off your burdens. Throw off the burdens that you've been carrying around that are her burdens and try again. And if I pass my burdens on to the Lord, that means I can take some more of my wife's burdens. And I can still hold them open and saying, God, it's not that I can't handle this, God. It's that I can know that, God, that with God, with you, I can handle it. 1 Peter 3:15 says, but in your hearts set apart Christ as Lord. But in your hearts set apart Christ as Lord. All of us, we need to remember today, if my Christianity doesn't work in my home, in whatever version of home life I have, and I honor you and respect you as a single person today, Jesus and the Apostle Paul was single. I honor and respect you today as a person who has been married, formerly married, and is not married today. You're honored and respected and loved. Single parents are honored, respected, and loved, and blessed today. But this applies so much to all of us. If your Christianity doesn't work at home, it doesn't work. And let's give a separate word to parents. There is no church in the world. There is no pastor, children's minister, or youth pastor in the world that can undo the lack of Christianity that's in at home. That makes sense? If I don't pray with my family and lead them and talk about the Lord at home and talk about what God's doing in my marriage with my family, if I can't say to my child, hey, me and your mom had an argument today, but we're both praying about it. I'm sorry you had to see that, but the Lord Jesus is bigger than our problems. If I can't say that to my child, there's no youth pastor, no children's minister in the world, no pastor, no church. It's sometimes people even go and they change churches hoping that the next youth pastor will teach their child to do something different than they've personally been teaching their child to do at home. Did I explain that correctly? And so I want you, as whether you're single or married today, I want you to say this. The primary pastor of the children in my home is me. The primary example, if you're a man here today, the primary shepherd for your children in your home is you, O man of God. I've had too many times men bring their wives to counseling, like, tell her. No. Men need to mentor men. If any man has anything ahead of any other man, they need to help that other man out, because we're all in kindergarten when it comes to understanding. If my Christianity doesn't work at home, it doesn't work. Any group of successful marriages and families, if there's anywhere, it ought to be in church, shouldn't it? But we're not there. But we could be. And I would encourage you today, as men and as women, you don't have to be the answer to the world's marital problems. But for you today, just don't lose the ground that God's given you. There's going to be times that you're going to feel like giving up. Don't give up. There's going to be times that you feel like, I just can never please her. Number one, she's pleased primarily by the Lord. You're an encourager to her to be pleased by the Lord. And there's going to be times that you feel like, we're not going to make it. Those are lies from the pits of hell. There is nobody else out there that it would be easier with. There is nobody else out there that it would be easier with. And I just really think today we can just take this at heart and say, God, help me gain ground. See, we're living in a world that people are throwing away marriage all the time and redefining marriage all the time. And we're tempted to kind of criticize people. Don't turn marriage into that. And that's true. Don't turn marriage into something that Genesis never meant it to be. But the real issue is not what other people are doing to marriage, but what Christians are doing. And if we say in our heart, God, come hell or high water, come pain, difficulty, I'm going to do what the Scripture says to do. The Bible tells me I can understand her. The Bible tells me that I can spend time with her and honor her. And I'm going to do it because the Bible told me to do it. Otherwise, it's destruction for us. Yesterday, I had a funeral to take part in. It was my neighbor's family from across the street that I lived with 18 years over off of Reese Road. And it was they had a son about my age, and they had a daughter about my sister's age. And I love that street, Norcross Drive. I love that street because that street taught me a lot about church. In fact, one neighbor invited us to church, and my mom got saved just before I was born. And that was the woman who passed away, and we did her funeral yesterday. And I got to stand up before God and these witnesses at that funeral and say, why do we look up to her so much? Why do we honor her so much? You know, I got to thinking, she didn't invent anything. She didn't have any degrees. I'm not sure she graduated high school. She didn't, she wasn't the president of any organization. She was no major influencer. Nobody knew her name. But why do I look up to her? Why did I admire this neighbor across the street so much? Why? Because she never gave up loving her husband and children to the end, and she had a tough time. She never gave up. With no degrees, no honor, no influence, no credibility to her name whatsoever. The truth is, in our society, these are the people that we should hold up and honor. Because her and her husband were married 57 years, 2 months, and 1 day. 57 years, 2 months, and 1 day. And it is okay. You might not make it. I calculated it for me and Melanie. We'd be married until, if we got married much later, you know, at 26, and this woman got married at 16. But it's going to be the year 2055 when me and Melanie have been married 57 years. So you might not live that long. But make it our goal to live until our last breath. And when they put me in the ground and when they put you in the ground, let some whippersnapper young preacher boy who might have been I was the across the street neighbor. They remember when I was born, and now I'm preaching their funeral, okay? Let some young kid stand up over your grave and say these words. They held marriage in honor. With no degrees, no reputation, no matter what the reputation was. Be known, men, for how you treat your wife more than what you did at work. Be known by how you treat your wife more than how much money. Be known as a man who understood, who honored, who maybe never graduated kindergarten, but also never quit school. Let's pray together.